Today we're very happy to have with us Professor Giuseppe Palmisano, who will speak on the protection of social rights in Europe, challenges and prospects. And you may know that Professor Palmisano is a full professor of international law and director of the Institute for International Legal Studies of the National Research Council of Italy. It's like the CNRS in France. Italy has also its National Research Council. He's based in Rome. Formerly he was in Camerino. And he is also a member and even president currently of the European Committee of Social Rights at the level of the Council of Europe. So we have a great expert with us who is really focusing on protection of social rights, but he has many academic interests and areas of expertise, especially in international human rights law, but also on issues such as the rights of migrants, the right to self-determination of peoples, state responsibility, has had a very instrumental role in the drafting of the International Law Commission's draft articles on state responsibility, international dispute settlement. So really, we are delighted to have Professor Palmisano with us. Let me just say a few words about why we think this is a very important topic for Europe today. Because the protection of social rights, many of us talk about it, many of us pay lip service to it, but to be honest, there is something of a, let me call it, weakness or asymmetry in the whole setup of the European Union system. And you see it in a certain way in the references that are being made to the European Social Charter in the EU treaties and legislation, because it has gone with ups and downs. Also in the case law of the European Court of Justice, I would say. We all know that the European Social Charter, which actually was first adopted in 1961, so a long time ago, more than 55 years ago, that this European Social Charter has been, and still is, the most wide-ranging and comprehensive legal instrument for the protection of social rights in Europe. Far beyond just employment rights, labor law, and social protection, it's actually a real comprehensive, overarching type of instrument. And it is not just a very interesting document in terms of substance, but it is also very interesting in terms of its so-called monitoring mechanisms, because indeed there are obligations that have to be implemented by the state parties, and the most peculiar and effective of those mechanisms is the so-called collective complaints procedure, according to which some entities are entitled to lodge complaints before the European Committee of Social Rights concerning the alleged violation by a state of one or more of the Charter's rights. Now, as you can imagine, especially in today's world, after what happened since 2007, the fall of Lehman Brothers, financial crisis, Eurozone, sovereign debt crisis, migration crisis, and much more, there are crucial issues in these days of economic crisis and austerity measures with regard to social protection and social rights, the fight against poverty, against social conclusion. And we know there have been many issues of, let's say, tensions between the solutions or the programs prescribed to tackle those crises and the very protection of core social rights. And it is there really that I think the great topicality of this lecture and the topic comes from. It is really a way of bringing back to our attention the heritage, and I would say the acquis, to use an EU term, the acquis of social rights protection that we have meticulously built up in the Council of Europe context, and which I'm sure is also today more than ever relevant for the European Union itself. So it's with great pleasure that I give Professor Palmisano the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Bouders, first of all, for inviting me at this high-level, I hope, lecture on the protection of social rights in Europe today, and I wish to thank also the, in general, the Leuven Center for Global Governance Studies, and for giving me the opportunity to give a contribution to this important project, I mean the frame project. And thank you also for your very exhaustive introduction, in the sense you made a sort of table of contents of what I'm going to say during my lecture. So, as you know, of course, the protection of social rights in Europe, I mean at the international, regional, European level, is guaranteed mostly by the European Social Charter. And this year we celebrate the 20th anniversary of revised Social Charter, which was signed the 3rd of May, 1996. But the Charter, as Professor Wouters just recalled, is much older than this. The European Social Charter has been signed 55 years ago, in 1961 in Turin. And at the time it was the, so to say, the second born daughter in the family of human rights treaties adopted within the Council of Europe, after its elder sister, the European Convention of Human Rights. Just like the European Convention of Human Rights, the Social Charter arises from the decision of European states, of the Council of Europe, to adopt a treaty to give binding force to the rights which were enshrined in the 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And as you know, the Council of Europe opted, in the same way as the UN, for adopting two separate treaties, one on civil and political rights, which was the 1950 Convention on Human Rights, and the other on economic and social rights, which was the European Social Charter, and was adopted 11 years later. But though being in force since the beginning of the 60s, the Charter remained for years a somewhat obscure and virtually ineffective instrument. And it is only in the 90s, at the end of the Cold War, when the first Central European state, Hungary, joined the Council of Europe, that the Council of Europe decided to relaunch, so to say, the Social Charter. The idea was both to make the Charter effective by aligning it as closely as possible to the European Convention of Human Rights, and to modernize it by adding new rights in order to take into consideration the individual and collective social needs which were emerging in a changing world. I could also say that by virtue of the institutional reforms started in those years, the Council of Europe intended to give a substantial meaning to the principle that human rights are indivisible and that social rights are human rights on an equal footing with civil and political rights. It's hardly necessary to recall you that a few years before the European Social Revised Charter was adopted, there was the Vienna Conference on Human Rights. So the institutional reforms that I've just mentioned took the form of three protocols adopted in 1988, 1991, and 1995, and at the end, the revised Social Charter in 1996. In 1988 came the first additional protocol, which added new rights. In 1991 was adopted the amending protocol improving the supervisory mechanism. And in 1995 was adopted another additional protocol providing for a system of collective complaints. The culmination of this reform process came in 1996 with the adoption of a revised charter, which added a number of new rights while at the same time incorporating the basic content of the 1961 charter and its protocols. Today, and you can see here the most important news of the revised European Social Charter. Today, the revised European Social Charter is probably at the international level the most wide-ranging and comprehensive legal instrument for the protection of social rights. The 31 substantive articles of the revised charter cover a broad range of individual and collective rights, spanning across many social areas. Among such rights, I would say employment rights, including the right to work and to employment, the rights at work and the right to decent working conditions with respect to pay, working hours, holidays and dismissal protections, as well as the collective rights of workers to organize, to bargain collectively and to form and join trade unions. These represent certainly the main pillar of the Charter, probably the most traditional one. Social protection is another pillar of the Charter, and I would add a cornerstone in the construction of the Council of Europe concerning social rights. In fact, the Charter addresses all aspects of social protection. It provides for the right to social security in its various branches, such as pensions, sickness cover, unemployment benefits, occupational accidents, insurance, and family benefits. And it guarantees also an enforceable right to social and medical assistance for persons in need. But the revised social charter goes beyond employment rights, as Professor Wouters recalled, providing a more general global approach to what are known today as societal issues. I refer, for example, to the right to protection of health, the right to housing, the protection of the family, the protection and education of children and young persons, the right of disabled persons to social integration and participation in the life of the community, the right to protection against poverty and social exclusion, which requires states to adopt a global and coordinated approach to fighting poverty and social exclusion. And I would also stress that the Charter guarantees all these rights in a non-discriminatory way. Non-discrimination is not only guaranteed in matters of employment and between men and women, but it is a fundamental principle which applies to all the rights of the European Social Charter. According to Article E of the Charter applies regardless of race, sex, age, color, language, religion, opinions, national origin, social background, state of health, or association with a national minority. And it is clear that this list of grounds has not to be intended as exhaustive. Therefore, from the standpoint of the persons protected, I think it is correct to say that the Charter, more than any other international and European normative instrument, takes care of the essential needs of individuals in their daily lives. And the common rationale of all its provisions is the assumption that human beings must have the right to enjoy decent living conditions as members of the organized community in which they live. Conditions such as to allow for them to live in dignity rather than merely survive. At the same time, from the standpoint of the political and legal commitment required by states' parties, it can be said that the European Social Charter, more than any other international instrument, pushes states to provide themselves with an advanced and efficient public welfare system. Let me add that, considering that the wide range of different rights covered by the Charter, and in view of facilitating the participation of states to this treaty, the acceptance of the Charter provisions is regulated by a la carte system that enables states to choose with certain conditions, under certain conditions and with certain limitations, the provisions that they are willing to accept as binding international legal obligations. You see here this a la carte system. Each state party undertakes to consider itself bound at least six of the following nine articles, and you see the hardcore of the Charter, and in addition to a number of provisions, provided that the total number of articles for number of paragraphs, which are, I think, 93, is not less than 16 articles or 63 numbered paragraphs. But the Charter is not merely a Bill of Rights, a simple catalogue of rights that states declares to uphold. The Charter also provides for a specific monitoring mechanism aimed at guaranteeing the implementation of obligations assumed by states parties. A mechanism which, of course, does not overcome the well-known limits of almost all international mechanisms of control and monitoring. But this mechanism has some impact on national laws and practices, and by consequence on the effective enjoyment of the rights by the individuals and groups protected by the Charter. Such mechanism, which is embedded in the institutional framework of the Council of Europe and which focuses on the role played by the European Committee of Social Rights, which is a body of 15 independent experts that I have the responsibility and honor in the spirit to preside over, envisages two distinct supervision procedures. One is a typical reporting procedure, consisting in the evaluation by the committee of periodic reports presented by states on the implementation of a charter in their legislation and actual practice, and we adopt conclusions of non-conformity or conformity with the charter. The other mechanism is the so-called collective complaints procedure, which is an optional procedure, concerns only those states' parties that have expressly accepted it. And according to this procedure, social partners and non-governmental organizations are enabled to directly apply to the European Committee of Social Rights for rulings on possible violations of a charter in the country concerned in specific cases. Let me say something more about this two procedure. The reporting procedure has many merits, and it is still a key weapon, so to say, in the social charter's arsenal. However, considering the way in which it has been organized and implemented in the last years, by a rigid division into four predetermined groups of the provisions of the charter, and the obligation for states to report every year only on one group of provisions, the reporting procedure risks sometimes to reduce itself to a mere bureaucratic or a routinary exercise. Moreover, sometimes the conclusions of the committee risk becoming quite slow and ineffective. For example, if changes in domestic legislation and practices have intervened between each supervision cycle. In other terms, I would say that length and obsolescence are the main disadvantages of a reporting procedure. The collective complaints procedure is indeed a quasi-judicial and adversarial procedure, and it has already proved to be a very significant mechanism for supervising state compliance. This for many reasons. In the first place, the collective complaints procedure allows to identify specific cases of social rights violations, giving, on the one hand, the opportunity to the state concerned to remedy them and to prevent new violations, but also giving, on the other hand, the possibility to affected individuals or groups to obtain the re-establishment of their rights. You can see here the organizations which are entitled to lodge collective complaints. Second, this procedure permits to put the abstract normative prescriptions of the social charter to the test of reality, that is, to the test of specific concrete situations. I would say, in other words, it permits to specify what states actually have to do or must avoid to do or have to prevent in order to guarantee, in given situation, the social rights of individuals or groups of different individuals. Last, but not least, the collective complaints procedure is important because it opens the door of a social charter system to the civil society, to NGOs and the world of workers. This means opening the European system for the protection of social rights to its very beneficiaries, who are directly and individually interested in the implementation and enjoyment of such rights. These kind of subjects are indeed the best guardians, I would say, much more than states and governments, of the rights established by the European Social Charter. And evidence of this is the fact that since its entry into force, the collective complaints procedure has become the Charter's flagship procedure, thanks to which it is now talked about and attracts the kind of media coverage it had never experienced before. And it also caused the European Committee of Social Rights to build up an important body of case law, clarifying the meaning, implications, and actual effects of charter rights with respect to many, many different subject matters. But after this description of the charter systems and about the protection of social rights under this system, I have to add that in the last years, all this system is put, so to say, under increasing stress and is faced with crucial external and internal problems. Let me just mention three different concerns which represent today real challenges for the social charter system, but more in general for the protection of social rights in Europe. First, as Professor Vaugers also recalled, a major issue of concern and difficulty that confronted in the last years since 2008 the protection of social rights in Europe is linked with a negative impact on workers, families, and most vulnerable people of the continuing economic crisis and of the measures adopted by states to cope with such crisis. Inadequate levels of social security and social assistance benefits continue indeed to disproportionately affect those who are most vulnerable, the poor, the elderly, the sick. Public policies continue to be unable to stem a generalized increase in poverty and unemployment in Europe. Also, healthcare systems are under growing pressure from austerity measures. And there are signs that the protection of health and safety at work has already been downgraded. Second, the last years have also been challenging as a result of the refugee and migrant crisis. In 2015, more than 1 million migrants and refugees crossed into Europe seeking refuge from war, poverty, terror, torture, persecution, and creating division in Europe, namely in the EU and EU member states, over how best to deal with resettling people. Guaranteeing these 1 million people hospitality, respect for their dignity and fundamental rights, prompt and proper social integration in host countries is a major challenge for the states' parties to the European Social Charter, a challenge that cannot be missed. And third, I refer to terrorist attacks and violence in Paris, Brussels, in Nice, and elsewhere in Europe. The social background of the authors of these attacks clearly show that violent extremism and attacks against the life of European citizens, against democracy and European civilization, do not come from outside Europe, but from within Europe. They are generated from and feed on poverty, social exclusion, and frustration. And they are possible when and where individuals and groups cannot enjoy decent living conditions as members of organized community in which they live. When and where they cannot equally enjoy their fundamental social rights like the right to work, to education, or to health. In this regard, let me quote what the Secretary General of the Council of Europe rightly pointed out in 2015 report. Political systems seen to protect social rights are likely to command greater levels of public confidence. In addition, the cohesive quality of these rights has taken on a new importance against the backdrop of ongoing austerity, rising populism, and in the fight against violent extremism and radicalization. By promoting equal opportunity, social rights encourage individuals to remain within the mainstream society and help lessen the appeal of other, more extreme or divisive paths. End of quotation. On this background, consensus is progressively gathering at the political level, but also at the legal and, I would say, academic level, around the idea that there is a need to bring respect for social rights and the European Social Charter system for protection of social rights back to the center of the European political and legal stage. This means, in particular, three kinds of possible initiatives. First, to enlarge the participation of states to the system of European Social Charter. Then, to strengthen, improve, and even update the system of protection of social rights. And mostly, to enhance existing synergies at the European level between the Council of Europe, Social Charter, and the European Union to better protect social rights and reinforce the European model centered on respect for social rights and advanced welfare systems. As for the issue of enlarging the participation of states to the system of social charter, this means, for example, to bring about greater acceptance of revised social charter. This respect, I remind you that nine state parties to the charter have not ratified yet the revised social charter, and that seven, after the Brexit, of them are EU member states. But this means even more, bring about greater acceptance of the collective complaints procedure, that up to now only 15 states have accepted. This in order to achieve an effective application of the Charter as uniformly as possible throughout the regional space of the Council of Europe. As for the improvement and updating of the system, let me refer in particular to one improvement that would be, in my view, very important to make the system of the Charter well equipped to face the challenges of our days. I refer namely to those challenges brought about by increasing migration and flows of refugees to Europe. The improvement in question concerns the personal scope of application of Charter, as it is established in the appendix of the Charter. According to paragraph 1 of the appendix, which constitutes an integral part of the Charter, the provisions of the Charter include foreigners only insofar as they are nationals of other parties lawfully resident or working regularly within the territory of the party concerned. In essence, the effect of this paragraph is that the system for the protection and control of social rights provided for by the European Social Charter does not apply to first state nationals and also to nationals from other state parties who, in a short but not entirely appropriate definition, are usually referred to as irregular migrants. The most questionable aspect of this limit, not the only one, but the most questionable, concerns the exclusion of foreigners who, though being within the jurisdiction of state parties and legally resident within their territory, are first state nationals. So it's not easy to pinpoint the reasons behind the decision not to extend the protection offered by the European Social Charter to first state nationals who are lawfully resident, I repeat, or working legally in the territory of a state party, a decision that dates back to the signature of the 1961 Charter. But whatever the reasons for deciding decades ago not to extend the scope of the European Social Charter to first state nationals, such a decision hardly appears consistent with the rational and legal nature of a charter intended as a human rights instrument aimed at protecting human dignity and rights which are essential for upholding such dignity. And indeed, from a point of view of a personal scope of application, the charter is a sort of anomaly. One cannot find the same kind of limitation in other international and European legal instruments aimed at protecting human rights in general or social rights in particular. At the universal level, the 1966 International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, for example, obliges state parties to apply its provisions to all individuals without distinction between citizens and foreigners or between foreigners according to their nationality. In a similar way, the various conventions on labor rights and standards, also social security standards, adopted within the framework of the International Labour Organization, provide that the respective provisions be applied by states parties to all workers legally residing in the state territory, regardless of their nationality. Coming to the European level, it is hardly necessary to recall that under Article 1 of the 1950 European Convention of Human Rights, in relation to which the European Social Charter is considered as complementary, states parties are under the obligation to secure the rights and freedoms enshrined in the Convention and its successive protocols too, to everyone within their jurisdiction, and not just to their own citizens and to nationals of other states parties to the Convention. And the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, in Chapter 4 and in Articles 15, 23, 26, extends the respect for social rights not only to nationals of EU member states, but to any person living and working legally within the European Union. In brief, I think that the exclusion of first state nationals from the scope of the European Social Charter represents a real anomaly in the framework of international instruments dealing with human rights, and also this means that these remarks I just made means that the same states parties to a charter have in fact already committed themselves in legal context other than the social charter to guaranteeing social rights in their territory beyond the limited personal scope set out in the appendix of the social charter, in terms which also include nationals from non-European states. I would add that today, more than 10 or 15 years ago, the demographic and social changes brought about by the increasing migration to Europe, due also to the massive influx of refugees, make more evident the inadequacy of a personal scope limitation imposed by the appendix. It becomes less and less understandable and acceptable that under the European Social Charter, a state party, for example, Sweden, Italy, or Germany, is obliged to ensure the right to a fair remuneration, or to safe and healthy working conditions, or to adequate medical assistance to workers from another European country, nationals from, for example, Ukraine, Portugal, or Turkey, while it is not obliged to ensure the same rights to workers from non-European states, for example, Egypt, Syria, Somalia, Pakistan, even if the person is permanently resident in the state or holds a long-term residence or working permit. The fact that the latter persons, in contrast to the former, cannot, under the European Social Charter, invoke and obtain from the state in which they live and work respect for social rights constitutes, in my view, a serious discrimination. Well, beyond the possibilities offered by the ars interpretandi, as applied, as we try to apply by our committee, in view of overcoming the limit imposed by the wording of the appendix, it is clear that this overcoming could only come from a deletion of the, or a substantial modification of a limitation which has been expressly established and formally accepted by states parties to the Charter. The main road to achieving such a result would be an amendment to the appendix. An amended text could, for example, establish that the provisions of a Charter apply to all foreigners lawfully resident or working legally within the territory of a party concerned, and not only to nationals of other states' parties to the Charter. However, an alternative way, procedurally and politically less problematic, of reducing this limitation could be that of unilateral declarations made by willing states' parties, say, like-minded, aimed at affirming their intention to extensively apply the provisions of a Charter, or most of them, not only to foreigners who are nationals of other states parties to the Charter, but also to all foreigners, at least those lawfully resident or working regularly within their territories. And having this in mind, The Committee on Social Rights took the initiative in 2011 on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of the 1961 Social Charter to send a letter to all states parties containing a proposal of adopting a declaration of this kind. I have to note that the committee's initiative has not thus far been able to achieve the desired result. Only two states have replied to the committee's invitation, Lithuania and the Netherlands, and both states have responded negatively. However, I'm still convinced that such change is more and more important to reinforce and improve the system of protection of social rights established by the Charter. But I come now to the second and last main part of my lecture, which concerns the third need to which I referred to a few minutes ago, and precisely the need to enhance existing synergies at the European level between EU and the European Social Charter to better protect social rights. You know that the issue of social rights is relevant not only to the Social Charter, of course, but also to the European Union law. This is the reason why it deserves attention to examine the relationship between the two legal systems, similarities, differences, and possible divergences, and their mutual relevance, the cross-references, so to say, between the two. I would add that this is actually very important due to the fact that due to the fact that all EU member states are also parties to the Charter, and that the implementation of EU normative acts and policies is having an increasing impact on a number of fields of relevance to social rights. And such impact should clearly not be in contrast with the legal obligations to protect social rights as they are enshrined in the Social Charter. In proposing some reflections on this topic, which is at the same time quite legally complex and politically thorny, I would start, first of all, by noting that the EU law, or more precisely, certain community acts and directives, have indeed been a source of inspiration for the revised charter. I refer in particular to the Community Charter on the Fundamental Social Rights of Workers, which is a declaration adopted in 1989 by the heads of state and government of the European Economic Community at the time, and which in turn, this Community Charter drew its inspiration from the 1961 Social Charter. On the basis of the 1989 declaration, community institutions have gradually adopted a number of directives relating to labor law or other social issues. Some of the provisions of the revised charter precisely draw on such directives. For example, this concerns Article 2, Paragraph 6 of the Charter, of the European Social Charter, on the right to just conditions of work, and especially to information about the employment contract. Article 7, Paragraph 2 of the Social Charter, on the right of children and young persons to protection, especially the ban on employment of those under the age of 18 in dangerous or unhealthy occupations. Article 8, Paragraph 4, on the right of employed women to protection of maternity, especially the regulation of night work and the definition of women workers covered by this provision. Article 25 of the European Social Charter, on workers' right to protection of their claims in the event of the insolvency of their employer. And Article 29 of the European Social Charter, on the right to information and consultation in collective redundancy procedures. All these provisions have been inspired by community directives or by the Community Charter of 1989. With this in mind, the European Committee of Social Rights, when interpreting and applying the revised charter, very often takes positive account of EU law and of the way in which it influences the law and practice of states parties to the charter. This is true when the committee deals, for example, with the changes in women's rights so as to ensure full equality between women and men, or when we deal with the minimum age for employment in certain occupations regarded as dangerous or unhealthy, or with Article 29, providing that the states must impose on employers an obligation of information and consultation on employee representatives in collective redundancy procedures. And this is also true when, with respect to the issue of health and safety at work, where, according to the Charter, national law on prevention of and protection from risks must be in conformity with international reference standards. And in this case, a state is considered to fulfill this general obligation if it has transposed most of the community acquis in the relevant field. These are some examples. But I would now try to present the other side of the coin, so to say. I mean the existing links between EU law and the Charter from the standpoint of EU law, that is, the primary and secondary EU law sources and other non-binding EU texts which refer expressly or indirectly to the Charter. First of all, we find a reference to the Charter in the preamble to the Treaty on European Union, paragraph 5, where member states have expressly confirmed, I quote, their attachment to fundamental social rights as defined in the European Social Charter and in the 1989 Committee Charter of Fundamental Social Rights of Workers. Another explicit reference is found in Article 151 of the Treaty on the Function of the European Union, which states, I quote, "The Union and the Member States, having in mind fundamental social rights, such as those set out in the European Social Charter and in the Community Charter of Fundamental Social Rights of Workers, shall have as their objectives the promotion of employment, improved living and working conditions, so as to make possible their harmonization while the improvement is being maintained, proper social protection, dialogue between management and labor, the development of human resources with a view to lasting high employment and the combating of exclusion." Moving to secondary EU law, the Social Charter has been explicitly mentioned in some directives and decisions. In some cases, the Charter is referred to in what can be called a without prejudice clause, which is inserted in the relevant EU Act. For example, in Directive 2014-36 on the conditions of entry and stay of third country nationals for the purpose of employment as seasonal workers, when one can find, I quote, "This directive should apply without prejudice to the rights and principles contained in the European Social Charter." Similarly, in another directive, Council Directive 2003-86, on the right to, I choose another example, on the right to family reunification, it is said, "This directive is without prejudice to more favorable provisions of the European Social Charter, the amended European Social Charter of 1996, it's not the amended, it's the revised Social Charter, but the legal wording of this directive is not very correct, and the European Convention on the Legal Status of Migrant Workers of 1977. In other cases, the Charter, the European Social Charter, is taken into consideration in the preamble to the relevant text. For example, in the preamble to decision number 50/2002 EC, establishing a program of community action to encourage cooperation between member states to combat social exclusion, it is said that the community and the member states, I'm quoting, "taking note of fundamental principles, such as those set out in the European Social Charter of 1961 and the revised Social Charter," here is correct, "of 1996, in particular in Article 30 thereof, on the right to protection against poverty and social exclusion, shall have as an objective the combating of exclusion." But as for primary EU law, the Social Charter has been mostly taken into consideration within the framework of a Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, which, as you know, with the entry into force of the Treaty of Lisbon in December 2009, was given the same binding legal force as the EU treaties. Even if it is not explicitly referred to in the text of the provisions of the Charter of Fundamental Rights, the Social Charter is mentioned as a source of inspiration for many provisions of EU Charter in the official explanations of the Charter of Fundamental Rights. I refer in particular to Chapter 4 on solidarity rights, which relates inter alia to workers' right to information and consultation within the undertaking, the right to bargain collectively and to collective action, the right of access to placement services, protection against unjustified dismissal, fair and just working conditions, the prohibition of child labor and protection of young people at work, family life and professional life, social security and social assistance and health care. You have here a complete table of references. Lastly, I would also point out that the Court of Justice of the EU, in a number of decisions, has made an express reference to the Charter, at least in four different ways, as the President of the Court of Justice, Judge Leonard, recently noted. One is using the Social Charter as a source of inspiration for and interpretation of some provisions of the Charter of Fundamental Rights. Another way is referring to the Social Charter as a source for reconstruction of some general principles of EU law. A third way is interpreting the so-called principles of EU social law in the light of the Social Charter. And fourthly, the reference to the Charter and to the fact that all EU member states are also parties to the Charter is made by the Court of Justice to give a reinforced legal value to the obligation for member states to protect certain social rights which are already enshrined in EU law, particularly labor law rights. Therefore, considering primary and secondary EU sources, the Charter of Fundamental Rights, as well as the case law, the Court of Justice, one could say that most of social and labor rights granted by the Social Charter, the European Social Charter, are also recognized and matched by corresponding safeguards in EU law, albeit with some differences and exceptions. However, in the implementation by member states of EU law policies and acts, problems have arisen, may arise, relating to the observance of the duties and obligations to respect social rights under the Social Charter. And in some cases, such problems stem precisely from the content or implications of EU normative acts, policies, or even judicial decisions. Let me say that this is not very surprising, nor should be considered to be pathological, so to say, from a legal perspective. One should, in fact, bear in mind that the EU law and the Social Charter are two distinct and different normative systems of law. On the one hand, the object and scope of European Social Charter is undeniably delimited and specialized. The Charter, the European Social Charter, concerns exclusively the protection of social rights, to be intended as a fundamental, I would say constitutional, for part of the Social Charter, legal and political value. On the other hand, the EU system is far more wide-ranging and complex. Its fundamental values are not just social rights or human rights in general. It pursues also other objectives, as you know, relating to the realization of a European single market, to economic freedoms, competition, budgetary equilibrium, and so on. But also for this very reason, EU institutions and organs, in exercising their wide-ranging and increasing competences, do frequently have occasion to address and impact on social rights or social rights-related issues, including work organization and working conditions, occupational health and safety, coordination of social security matters, social dialogue, free movement of workers, social inclusion and the fight against poverty, non-discrimination, and the needs of vulnerable people, such as people with disabilities and elderly people. Within the EU system, it is therefore possible that the balancing of all the relevant values and objectives leads to an outcome which is not consistent with an adequate protection of social rights. And in the long term, this can cause not just a number of violations of the social charter, but also a risk of regression of European political and social model centered on respect for social rights and advanced welfare systems. It's against this background that some divergences between the two systems linked to the application of the European Social Charter in national law, that have indeed been brought to light by the European Committee of Social Rights. First of all, in the conclusions adopted in the course of its supervision work based on national reports, I mean the so-called reporting procedure. An example is that of the right of migrant workers to family reunification, so the first example there, which is established by Article 19, paragraph 6 of the Charter. Concerning this right, our committee, the Committee of Social Rights, observed in a statement of interpretation 2011 that Directive 2003/86 on the right to family reunification contains provisions allowing the member states concerned to adopt and apply rules that infringe Article 19, paragraph 6 of the Charter. And this concerned in particular three issues: the length of residence requirement for migrant workers wishing to be joined by members of their family. In this connection, the committee has always considered that a length of more than 1 year is excessive and consequently in breach of the Charter. Another issue was the exclusion of social assistance from the calculation of the income of a migrant worker who has applied for family reunification. In this respect, we pointed out that migrant workers who had sufficient income to provide for the members of their families should not be automatically denied the right to family reunification because of their origin of such income, insofar as they are legally entitled to the benefits they may receive. A third issue was the requirement that members of the migrant workers' family sit language and or integration tests to be allowed to enter the country or pass these tests once in the country, with leave to remain depending on their success. On this subject, we considered that insofar as this requirement, because of its particularly stringent nature, discouraged applications for family reunification, it constituted a condition likely to prevent family reunification rather than facilitate it, as the Charter imposes. But apart from the reporting procedure, problems emerged mostly within the framework of the collective complaints procedure, where the committee, the European Committee of Social Rights, noted and stressed out in some decisions the divergences and possible frictions between the two systems, the Social Charter and the EU law. These occurred, for example, in the decision of collective complaints number 55/2009, the decision was at the beginning of 2011, I think, where the issues at stake concerned the organization of working time, in particular the question of excessive length of weekly working time or no increased rate of remuneration for overtime work. Here, the committee had to assess whether the implementation by France of an EU normative act, Directive 2003/88, brought about a violation of Article 2, paragraph 1, and Article 4, paragraph 2 of the Charter, respectively, on the right to just conditions of work and the right to a fair remuneration. And the committee took the view, on the one side, that the practical arrangements agreed between the EU member states, if properly applied, would permit the exercise of the rights contained in Articles 2, paragraph 1, and 4, paragraph 2 of the Charter. But it also noted that the directive provided for many exceptions and exemptions which might adversely affect respect for the Charter by states in practice. And accordingly, it considered that depending on how EU member states transpose those exceptions and exemptions into national law, or combine them, the situation could be compatible or incompatible with the Charter. And in the specific case, as regards excessive length of weekly working time and no increased rate of remuneration, The committee found that France actually infringed its obligations under Articles 2 and 4 of the Charter. In other cases, a negative impact on social rights can stem, according to the committee, from political and economic measures adopted at the EU level, also at EU level, and de facto imposed on a member state. An example of these are some decisions adopted by the Committee of Social Rights on 2012 in collective complaints against Greece concerning a series of legislative measures, so-called austerity measures, adopted by this state to fulfill the requirements decided by the so-called Troika, IMF, World Bank, and the EU Commission, as preconditions for the loan installments in the context of a financial support mechanism agreed upon by Greece with the Troika in 2010. To limit myself by only focusing on labor rights, I recall that two of such complaints, 65 and 66, which were lodged by the General Federation of Employees of the National Electric Power Corporation and the Confederation of Greek Civil Servants, concern some measures reforming the labor market, labor contracts, and wage conditions. In particular, the Greek legislation introduced special apprenticeship contracts for young persons aged between 15 and 18 years, which, according to the committee's assessment, are excluded from the scope of labor legislation and have the practical effect of establishing a distinct category of workers who are not entitled, for example, to the annual 3 weeks leave with pay, and who are also excluded from the general range of protection offered by the Social Security scheme system. In addition, you know that the Greek legislation adopted a reduction of 32% at the time of the minimum wage, which has been applied to all employed persons under the age of 25, so that the minimum wage for young workers is now substantially below the national minimum wage and has fallen below the poverty threshold. Other provision of the same Greek legislation made it possible, in the context of an open-ended labor contract, to dismiss a person without notice or compensation during an initial probation period of 12 months. The committee stated that all these changes, which have been imposed on Greece also by the EU, are not compatible with the obligations to protect social rights under the European Social Charter, and in particular with the provision establishing the right of workers to annual holiday with pay, the right to a decent pay, the right to reasonable notice of termination of employment, and the obligation of state not to deteriorate the social security schemes. In a completely different context, the committee also found a violation of a charter deriving from the combined effect of an EU normative act, a directive, and the ruling of a court of justice, having a binding effect on the national judges of a state party to the charter. This occurred in particular in collective complaint number 85/2012 against Sweden. As you probably remember, this complaint concerned the adoption by Sweden of the so-called Lex Laval as a consequence of a preliminary ruling of the European Court of Justice. The new Swedish legislation, which took the place of the previous Lex Britannia, another Swedish legislation, was in fact considered necessary by Sweden in order for the Swedish legislation to comply with the EU directive on posted workers within the framework of the freedom to provide services, as interpreted by the Court of Justice in the Laval ruling of December 2007. To cut a long story, very long story short, the problem here was that this new Swedish legislation, as regards foreign posted workers, had imposed substantial limitation on the ability of Swedish trade unions to make use of collective action in establishing collective agreements on matters which go beyond the minimum rate of pay or other minimum conditions. The same legislation also considered to be admissible to grant posted workers minimum standards equivalent to those enjoyed by national workers without occupational experience at all, such as young people, even when the foreign posted workers have a long occupational experience and professional skills. Our committee, therefore, could not but find that the new Swedish legislation was and is in contrast with the European Social Charter, and in particular with the provisions establishing the right to bargain collectively and the right to strike, as well as the obligation of the state to guarantee foreign workers treatment not less favourable than that of national workers, respect to the remuneration and enjoyment of the benefits of collective bargaining. But let me see. Apart from the merits of this case, what deserves attention is the fact that the European Committee of Social Rights took the opportunity in this decision to clarify what is the relevance of EU law and policies from the standpoint of the assessment of respect by a state of a social charter, as well as what should be the proper approach of EU political, legislative and judicial institutions in view of facilitating an adequate observance of a charter by EU member state. Let me quote a few passages of this decision. First of all, the committee recalled that the fact that national provisions are based on a European Union directive does not remove them from the ambit of a charter. In this regard, the committee is neither competent to assess the conformity of national situations with a directive of the European Union, nor to assess compliance of a directive with the European Social Charter. However, when member states of the European Union agree on binding measures in the form of directives which relate to matters within the remit of the European Social Charter, they should, both when preparing the text in question and when transposing it into national law, take full account of the commitments they have taken upon ratifying the European Social Charter. It is ultimately for the committee to assess compliance of a national situation with the Charter, including when the transposition of a European Union directive into domestic law may affect the proper implementation of a charter. And this also applies to national provisions based on preliminary rulings given by the CJEU. Second step, the committee clarified that an alleged presumption of conformity of EU law with the Charter, the European Social Charter, cannot be properly invoked as an argument, as a kind of Bosphorus argument. In that respect, the committee first of all pointed out that the law of a charter and EU law are two different legal systems, and the principles, rules, and obligations constituting EU law do not necessarily coincide with the system of values, principles, and rights embodied in the charter. And then, even noting that, am I quoting again, EU rules, normative acts, and judicial decisions may often conform also with the requirements of a charter, especially now that the provisions of EU Charter of Fundamental Rights have legal force, the committee considered that neither the current status of social rights in the EU legal order nor the substance of EU legislation and the process by which it is generated would justify a general presumption of conformity of legal acts and rules of EU with the European Social Charter. Therefore, whenever it has to assess the situations where states take into account or are bound by legal rules or acts of the EU, the committee will examine on a case-by-case basis whether respect for the rights guaranteed by the Charter is ensured in domestic law. Now, to conclude, I would like to propose two very brief reflections on how to improve coordination of the two systems. First, as you know, all EU member states are part of the system of a charter, but there are differences regarding the commitments that they have entered to. 8 states are bound by the 1961 charter, 7 states, and 19 by revised charter. With the exception of 2 states, France and Portugal, which have accepted all the paragraphs of revised charter, then Italy, I think just one paragraph not accepted. The others have ratified a greater or lesser number of provisions of either version of a charter. And only 14 EU member states have accepted the protocol establishing a system of collective complaints. This results in a variety of situations and a variety of obligations. There is a clear lack of uniformity in the acceptance of charter provisions by the EU member states. While not amounting to an anomaly in itself, this lack of uniformity sometimes reveals a lack of consistency. Where the protection of some fundamental labor rights is concerned, I'm speaking about labor rights, some states have chosen not to enter any undertaking under the Charter. Yet, pursuant to the EU law, they have adopted legal instruments or measures providing equal or greater protection than that guaranteed in the social charter provisions that they have not accepted. In other words, while applying the EU binding standards in an area covered by the Charter, some states have not accepted the Charter provision establishing legally equivalent guarantees. Given this situation, it would be expedient on the part of European Union institutions to identify the Charter provision, the European Social Charter provisions, which EU member states should accept because they belong to the EU. Second, suggestion, so to say. It is of crucial importance to reinforce dialogue and exchanges between the Council of Europe institutions on the one side and the relevant bodies of the European Union, in particular the Commission, the Economic and Social Committee, the European Parliament, but also the Court of Justice, on the other. With a view to ensuring that the EU institutions take greater account of the Social Charter in the EU legislative process and judicial decisions. In this respect, let me refer to the EU initiative to develop a European pillar of social rights, which has been announced, as you know, by President Juncker in September 2015, and it is foreseen in the Commission work program for this year, 2016. The pillar is expected, as you know, to be a self-standing reference document of a legal nature, setting out key principles and values shared at EU level in the field of social policies and social rights. As president of the Committee of Social Rights, I really hope that the drafting of such document can be occasion for the EU to improve further its dialogue and synergy with the Council of Europe on social rights issues, with a view to achieve a better consideration of the European Social Charter by EU institutions in the process of adopting EU legislative acts and policy measures. I think it's better that I stop here because I already bored you too much. Thank you.